We've been working with a client for a couple of years now, developing concepts for his family expedition yacht to do global cruising. And we've looked at a number of different hull configurations and a number of different designs. These ones on the screen are not going to be the final design. We're just working with some naval architects right now and designers, and I'll be introducing those designs later on in the series. The first thing that we did together with the client was to define the mission for he and his family. So they wanted a long-range global cruising boat, so capable of going anywhere on the planet, on any of the oceans, in a variety of sea conditions. You wanted to be autonomous and, you know, you could call it living off the grid. We call it endurance, and the vessel would have to have at least 30 days of endurance. So this basically means that when you are cruising in a foreign location, in remote islands or different parts of the world, that you have on board everything that you need to exist for 30 days. At least without having to go into a port. And so that not only involves refueling, but it's about food storage, and then waste storage. He wants to have heli operations. So that means that you've got to put your helicopter equipment into a hangar, and that's environmentally controlled. It has all sorts of fire restrictions and fire codes, particularly in regard to refueling. And in addition to that, later on we'll discuss the crew has to be trained for that. He also wants to bring along a submersible, and we'll get into that later on in the series. And then of course the usual tenders and toys. And he has a specific list of tenders and toys that we're going to incorporate into the vessel. These are things that you really have to address at the outset of any project. It's the answers to these kinds of mission questions that the designers need to know as they start to create the vessel. Here's some other criteria that go into the design. They're almost mission statements. Safety is a given as far as safety of life at sea, but also redundant systems. A lot of boat designs, in fact, are not very secure when you're alongside a pier or even at anchor, as far as being boarded by people that you may not want to meet. So that goes into the criteria. Comfort is a given. This family does not want to have a lot of motion on the boat, so we're going to want to have a boat that rides in the sea comfortably and has stabilizers at anchor and underway. They also like to have a lot of natural light, and they like to have open deck space. So these are things that we'll get into when we get into the more granular details of the actual design. The owner wants to have a separated living space and workspace on board. So in effect, when he goes to work, he wants to leave the family quarters and head to a dedicated workspace in a different part of the vessel. Likewise, they would like to have a homeschooling space for children. And so, that will also be a part of the design criteria that we'll get into. Low emissions, obviously, and that's what we're going to spend the rest of this first episode talking about. People are very aware of the carbon footprint of mega yachts, and without going into it, I'll just tell you that there are actually websites that are tracking the carbon footprint of billionaires. And we saw in the last year that one of the yachts in Spain had paint splattered on it. And there's just a myriad of reasons why low emissions are desirable. And then there are all kinds of regulations that we're staring at, where these large vessels must decrease their carbon footprint. And so we're going to spend the rest of this talking about that. Now that we have our basic mission in mind and we're going into the design phase, we've got a lot of decisions to make about how this boat is going to have power. It's pretty much a given that it's going to be some kind of electric drive. And then the question is, how are you generating that electricity? Energy options that are being thrown around wildly in all the magazines and at the class societies and at the different yacht get-togethers include diesel, which is the traditional, but variations of that, LNG, hydrogen, which would be feeding the fuel cell, and then finally wind. And there's some variations in between there that we'll get into. Hybrid usually refers to the use of batteries, and batteries are not the solution. They serve some purpose. They can give you operations while you're idling around a port or in and out of a fjord or an environmentally sensitive area. So the battery is feeding the electric motors that are providing the drive. The batteries are also used for peak shaving. So in theory, you can put in a smaller diesel engine, your main power source, because when you have demand for peak power, you can then have the batteries kick in. And some captains claim that this kind of hybrid system can save them 20% to 30% on their fuel. It's also more efficient on the engines because they're running at their optimum RPM, and that's a whole other science. In terms of saving the planet, if you're charging your batteries using your diesel engines, you know, you can figure that one out. There's a lot of buzz about fuel cells right now. The fuel cell itself is converting the energy it gets from an external fuel source. So it could be hydrogen, and there's other variations that you can feed a fuel cell with. The whole thing about these systems, you need a tank five times as large to hold enough liquid hydrogen to get the same amount of energy as you would get from diesel. Hydrogen in its liquid form is easier to handle, but it has to be cooled down to -253 degrees. As much as a third of the energy in the hydrogen gas is expended on keeping it cool. DNV reports that the fires are difficult to detect because you can't really see them. The flames are invisible. DNV concludes in its maritime report projecting to 2050 that hydrogen gas will only have a limited importance as a ship fuel. And that's because of its high price, its low energy density, and there are challenges concerning storage and handling. And when they say challenges, you know, if you want to scare yourself, just read some of the reports and the studies about the handling of hydrogen, what can go wrong, and when something goes wrong, what are the outcomes? It's just probably not something that you'd be comfortable with sharing the inside of a steel hull with a hydrogen tank, but that's just me. And it doesn't matter because there's no supply chain. So with a lot of these things, they're just not gonna happen. One further comment about the hydrogen and the fuel cell mania that's going on right now is, you know, they say that it's a source of CO2-free energy. However, you gotta look at the full cycle. So let's say they were using offshore wind. That's certainly not free, and it's not without some carbon footprint to actually get those wind towers built and put up there. And then you got to process the different elements to come up with your liquid hydrogen and deliver them to the vessel. So while the vessel might be cruising along and everybody's in the hot tub thinking that this is, you know, that they're only creating water, it's not necessarily the environmental panacea or silver bullet that some people would present it as. So for our purposes, bringing it back to this project, we're not gonna do hydrogen, we're not gonna do fuel cells. This is a summary from a coalition of LNG suppliers, so it certainly has its own bias. However, using gray methanol, ammonia, and hydrogen made from unabated fossil gas, whatever that is, will generate more greenhouse gas emissions than the conventional fuel alternatives they're replacing. You know, is that true? I don't know. I'm not a scientist, but I've been reading everything I can about this, and I must say my attention span isn't that great, so a lot of times I fall asleep. However, they just don't seem to be practical or even usable, let's say for the next 5 or 10 years. So we're building a boat now. We've got to make a decision. We don't see a way forward with one of these alternative fuel scenarios. So rather than have the wind turbine capture the energy of the wind, why not just capture it right on board? It's obviously, it has worked for centuries. There are a lot of concepts. You can see a couple of them here for using new wind technologies. There's an abundance of wind around the world. With the evolution of sails and the ability to sail into the wind, you don't have to strictly follow the trade wind paths in order to benefit from wind power. As we all know, there are times when there's no wind. And so in the bad old days when there was no wind, you'd send a couple of lads out into a longboat and you would drag the big boat along with oar power. And in this case, this photograph is actually from a scrapbook of my dad's. And this was taken up in Labrador in the late 1920s when he was on a scientific expedition that took a large Gloucester schooner all the way to Labrador to map out and chart the coast. And I don't know if my dad's on that little boat rowing, but that is exactly how it used to be done. Here's some examples of where wind is being used commercially. And these are real examples because that's a Cargill ship, and they actually took that to Brazil. The other one is a French transport company that is sending rockets from France down to French Guiana in South America to the launch pad. And they achieved 15% reduction of fuel on that trip, or 3.5 tons a day. Another interesting commercial application of wind is this French mini cargo ship. They built two of these in France that got launched, I think, last year, and they've already ordered up either 4 or 6 more. So it is a commercial success. It can, each of the vessels can carry around 100 containers at 10 knots, and they're making money, so they can build more of these. However, it only carries 100 containers. Assuming that they're talking about a 20-foot container, by my calculation, I might be wrong, so point that out in the comments if I am, but it would take about 200 of these vessels to carry the equivalent of one of these monstrous container ships. Then at the sort of high end of what you can do with sail power, applying today's modern designs and technologies and these new sail technologies, these are the Dyna rigs, rather well known, the Maltese Falcon and the Black Pearl. Coming back to our new build, and given what we've been seeing in the evolution of different power systems, it's pretty clear that diesel sail hybrid in 2024 is the best solution to have the minimal amount of carbon emission and still have a practical global expedition yacht. So obviously they are both available everywhere, except when there is no wind, but then you've got your diesel. In terms of what it's gonna cost you to cruise, this combination will pack the most bang for the buck in terms of moving around the planet in a fairly large vessel. Again, looking at the big picture in 2024, it doesn't seem that diesel engines, even with the efficiencies and the reduced emissions that you can get out of a modern diesel engine, will meet with the new IMO levels that are being set. So in combination with the sail hybrid, I assume that we are gonna meet those levels. And the other aspect of the diesel sail hybrid is that we will be able to generate electricity when we're under sail in ideal conditions. So we'll be able to, in theory, just as Black Pearl does, we're gonna be able to generate enough electricity to carry the hotel load of the vessel and possibly also to re-up the charge on the battery banks. So in this first episode, I covered a lot of technical ground. I'm gonna put links down below for anyone that wants to explore these different fuel alternatives and different propulsion alternatives. There are a lot of us in the large yacht industry that originally were sailors. And for those of us that have sailed across an ocean completely under sail power, we just have a feeling about navigating with sails and wind. For us, it's not a big reach to understand that. What is actually a bigger reach at this point in my understandings and based on my research is why has it taken so long for the mainstream industry to come back to wind power? And with all this new sail technology, why is it not becoming adapted more readily? Let's see, episode 2, we're gonna really get into the new sail technology. And in the following episodes, hopefully you're gonna see how we actually apply all this and it ends up being an amazing new vessel.